So new year, new videos, and a new camera. This is the long-anticipated Leica M11. Welcome back, everybody. This is the Leica M11. I am super excited to be making this video. Leica were kind enough to send me this camera a few weeks ago. Pretty much been shooting on it nonstop ever since. So why am I so excited about the M11? Well, for me, it comes down to the sensor that's in this camera. This is something you're not gonna find on any other system that's out there. So it's a 60 megapixel sensor, but it's also a tri-resolution sensor. So you can have this output at 60 megapixels. You can also have it output at 36 megapixels or even 18 megapixels. So you get all of the benefits of a high resolution sensor, but it does not sacrifice in terms of noise and performance when you get into higher ISOs. This really is one of the most versatile systems I've seen on any camera to date. It is extremely unique. I'm probably getting ahead of myself just a little bit. Let's start by talking about the design on this camera, what some of the differences are from the previous version. So at first glance, you're going to notice that Leica has retained the same design aesthetic from the previous M10 models, and so there's not a whole lot of change in terms of aesthetics. But looking at the back of the camera, you're going to notice that there's a slight change to the buttons. So the live view has been moved to the middle section, and it's actually been changed to a function button. So it is live view by default, but this button is customizable. In fact, speaking of customizable function buttons, there are now three. So on the M10, we had one on the front of the camera. Well, this button has been moved up to the top next to the shutter release. Of course, there's the function button I just mentioned on the back of the camera, and then there is a third custom function button as the rear dial can be pushed in. These are super easy to assign, so essentially you're just going to long press any of these function buttons. It's going to bring up a contextual menu, and you can select pretty much anything that you want to be able to control on the camera. These can also be assigned to user profiles. So if you want the buttons to change in different scenarios and to different configurations, you can assign them to different profiles and simply switch between them. The rear indicator light is much smaller, and it's been moved, and it's now next to the navigation panel. There's also a secondary light on the bottom of the camera on the battery release. And you're probably noticing that the bottom of the camera is probably the most radical design change. If you're used to M bodies, you're going to notice that this is the first M camera that does not have a base plate. In fact, it's the first M camera in 60 years that does not feature a base plate. So this is my M10P, and it has a base plate. So essentially, this is a plate that is removable. You can take this off, and it gives you access to the battery compartment and the SD card slot. Would probably argue that this is form that has no function necessarily. It's simply a nostalgic reference to the past. Either way, it's been replaced now, and so we have a removable battery, which actually puts this camera more in line with the Q2 or even the SL2 cameras. This battery features a double locking system, so to release the battery, you're going to flip the switch, and then you need to tap the battery to release it fully. This keeps it from falling out. The SD card slot is beneath the battery release, so think of this as a super low profile base plate. Now, before people complain that we don't have dual card slots, well, we actually sort of do. There is 64 gigabytes of internal storage in this camera, so if you forget your SD card, no problem. And with the new storage management feature in the menus, you can later copy all or selected images to the card from the internal storage. There's also USB-C connectivity finally, so not only can we transfer data from the camera using USB-C, we can also charge the camera. The menus have some subtle but very much improved changes. So what this does is it brings the camera more in line with the SL2 and Q2 cameras. So I really like the consistency that we have across all of Leica's camera models now. The biggest change is the first menu screen is now the overview menu, and you have 12 customizable touch functions that are on here, so usually when you dive into the menus, you probably won't have to go much further than this first page. The battery is obviously a new design, but I also want to mention that this is a major improvement over previous M batteries. So this one actually features 64% more capacity than the previous models did. So as we go through some of the new features on this camera, you're going to see why we now have a larger battery. So let's talk about battery life for a second, because with the M10P, I never had any complaints with battery life on that camera. In fact, I think the power management in that camera is so good. A lot of times I could go on a trip for a couple days and I'd have my battery charger with me and I'd still be at 50% after 2 days. And so it really handled power very well. Of course, that camera is also very simple in its operation. So you are metering when you have the camera on, but the sensor really only becomes active at the moment of release when you release the shutter. Some of you may remember on the M10 cameras that multi-matrix metering was only available if you were in live view. And so in other words, if you were just using this as a rangefinder and you had the live view screen off, you were just going to have center weighted metering. So that has now changed because the M11 has a huge design difference. On M10 cameras, when you turn on the power, you don't hear any sound at all. The camera just boots up silently. You're going to notice though on the M11 when I power the camera on, you're gonna hear the shutter open. The M11 is actually taking a full data readout off of the sensor whether you're in live view or not. So when it's determining exposure and white balance, it's going to be able to do those much more accurately than previous models. So this gives us access to multi-matrix metering finally. So real life experience with this, I've really noticed no difference between power consumption in the M11 and the M10. It's just as good. Literally, I will go out and shoot all day and I come back at the end and I'm at like maybe 70%, maybe 60%, depending on how heavy I've been shooting. It really is impressive. Of course, I also want to mention that this is a pre-production version of this camera, so there could be some changes in the firmware before the actual release, but I've been very impressed. This is obviously the silver version, but the M11 also comes in black. One thing I want to note is the black version will actually be 20% lighter in weight. So the reason for that is the silver version has the brass top cover plate that's under this finish. You can't really see it. So if you want a lighter camera that's a little easier to carry around, the black version might be the way to go. Okay, so now I want to talk about this new sensor because this is the highlight for me on this camera. This is the reason that you will want to upgrade. There is a noticeable difference in image quality between the M10 versions of this camera and the M11. So before we get into that, allow me to explain something here. Okay, this is probably going to sound a little bit picky, I don't know, but this is my M10P. I bought this a little over a year ago, and I have shot on it all year. I mean, this is the only camera that I've been using for my personal work. This is a 24 megapixel sensor in here. A lot of people will ask me, well, Ted, why didn't you go with the M10R versus the M10P? The M10R has a much higher resolution. Well, truth be told, before I bought the M10P, I actually rented both the M10P and the M10R. Both are outstanding cameras. This is not a slam against the M10R, but it's a common problem that you have with sensor design where you have a higher megapixel count, meaning there's more photosites on that sensor, then your pixel pitch isn't as good. And what happens is when you get into really low light situations and you're having to really push that ISO, the M10R did okay, but I could get a stop or two more of usable ISO with the M10P. Now, why is that important? Well, for me, the rangefinder is a camera that I pretty much take with me everywhere. I've always got this camera with me. And I want to be able to be in a situation that's very loose and casual. And if I have a shot that's at a restaurant at night and the lights are really low, I want to be able to have a camera that's going to respond to that. And so that's always a trade-off that I've had, is that I'm willing to give up some of that extra resolution. 24 pixels is still pretty decent, but the trade-off is that you get much better low light performance. So let's talk about how this is done with the M11, because it's quite different. So the M11 features a new custom backside illuminated CMOS sensor, and this is actually a triple resolution sensor. So it will resolve at 60 megapixels, 36 megapixels, and 18 megapixels. All three resolutions get full DNG RAW support with 14-bit color depth. You can also do the crop zoom thing like on the Q2 at all three resolutions. So this turns a prime lens essentially into three focal lengths. So if you have a 28 millimeter lens on the camera, you can emulate a 28 millimeter, a 36-ish millimeter, as well as a 50 millimeter lens. Okay, so it's a backside illuminated sensor, but it's still 60 megapixels. So one of the first things that I did when this camera arrived is I took it out at dusk to start shooting in really low light to push this to see what I could really do with it. I have to say, I was pleasantly surprised and very impressed. Sure, at 60 megapixels, you'll get a little bit of noise that hides in the shadow areas, but it's still way cleaner than the M10R was. And I think probably a lot of this has to do with the processor. We've got the Maestro 3 processor in here now, so that's doing a great job. And this is one thing that Leica's always been really good at, is performing well in low light. So when you do get that noise creep in, it renders it in a way that's probably a little more pleasant along the lines of film grain, although it's still very different, but this camera is really impressive in how it handles low light. Now the real bonus here is because we have a triple resolution sensor, we can resolve this below 60 megapixels with a full sensor readout. So when we do this, it works a lot like what's happening with cell phone technology. So many of you have seen how Samsung released a phone that's got a 103 megapixel sensor that's like half the size of my pinky nail. But the way it works is you're actually getting a 12 megapixel file by default. So what they're doing is they're taking a massive sensor, and through a process of oversampling and pixel binning, they're reducing the noise to give you better image quality at that lower resolution. So the same thing works with the M11. So way Leica are boasting it is that when you're at 33 megapixels, just one notch under 60, you're lowering the resolution, but you're going to be getting a cleaner image. There's also a dynamic range benefit as well. In fact, Leica are stating that you get 14 stops of dynamic range at 60 megapixels, and this increases to 15 stops of dynamic range when you go below 60. Of course, the lowest noise will be at the smallest size. Another thing that Leica have done with the M11 that's really cool is when you shoot both RAW and JPEG files at the same time, the resolutions are independent of one another. So you can shoot your RAW files at full 60p, and you can do a smaller JPEG, let's say, if you were delivering straight to an outlet, if you're doing some kind of event photography, or if you're doing media stuff. From a technical standpoint, Leica has essentially developed an algorithm for binning, which actually uses smart remapping of the bare filter array. So you use the entire sensor with no cropping. Another factor in this is the sensor cover glass. Leica has designed an ultra-thin, high-absorbing, dual-layer UV-IR filter glass that improves image quality for the M lenses. So this not only exceeds the performance from the M10R, it's also a higher resolution, and the performance is on par with what I was able to get out of the M10P for the last year. And so it's kind of interesting because Leica have effectively killed off one of their own models. So when you think of like the variations that come out, we had the M10, the M10P, the M10D, and then also the M10R. Well, the R was the resolution version. So the P and the R are now combined. So this is really an interesting move from a design standpoint in terms of what we'll see from Leica in the future, I think. So a few words on connectivity. So I'm a big fan of the Leica Photos app. I've used it with my M10P for remote shooting. You establish a Wi-Fi connection for the camera, it will connect, you get live view, the whole thing. It is pretty good. It just got a lot better. So if you prefer a wired connection, one of the bottlenecks is the proprietary lightning stuff with Apple. So one of the things that comes in the box with the M11 is this special cable here, USB-C to lightning. So if you've got an Apple device that you're using with Leica Photos, you're gonna get much faster transfer speeds using the USB-C to lightning cable, big plus. Also with Leica Photos 3.0, you're gonna get some other updates, which include things like geotagging, and my personal favorite, you'll be able to update your camera firmware from the app. Pretty cool. And also, there is a new Visiflex EVF. So this is not the new one. They didn't send me one of these. This is the old one, and I use it with my M10P quite often. If I'm doing something like macro using an adapter, or if you've got like a lens like the 35mm Aposumicron that has the macro mode, well, that doesn't really work with the rangefinder, so you can do macro mode with this one. This is the old one. It does do the alternate view here, so I can look down on it if I want. The new one is a little bit bigger. It's actually got a much higher resolution. That's something that people complained about with the old one quite a bit. I think it's going to be pretty cool, and it's kind of essential if you're going to do any macro work. And speaking of lenses, one of the highlights of the M system is being able to use lenses with razor-thin depth of field. So the Sumilux lenses like the 50mm f1.4, even the 90mm f1.5. There's also the Noctilux lenses like the 50mm f0.95 or even the 75mm 1.25. So if you're going to shoot wide open out in like bright sunlight, you're probably going to have some kind of neutral density filter on your lens. Well, there's two changes to the M11 that will assist with that. First of all, the base ISO on this camera is now 64, and there's also an electronic shutter that you can have kick in. So I have this set up in the menus to be a hybrid shutter. So basically what that means is it's going to use the mechanical shutter unless the camera determines that the shutter speed needs to be much faster than the limit there. So what that'll do is it'll kick into electronic shutter, and I can get up to 1/16,000th of a second. I'm actually more excited about having a lower ISO than I am having the electronic shutter because it's not perfect. When you get the electronic shutter going, and this is just the nature of the beast with a 60 megapixel sensor, that's a lot of lines to scan on a CMOS sensor. And if you're not careful and something's moving in your photo, you are going to get some jello action. But all in all, it's nice to have it. And as long as you're shooting something like a portrait or a still life or something that's not moving, you're probably going to find that very useful. So after using this camera very heavily for the last 3 weeks, I want to share some of my thoughts on this because I feel like I'm really excited about this camera. I want to tell you why. I think in the last couple years, we've seen, just with cameras in general, this drift towards stacked CMOS sensors and the ability to have speed on a camera. So you can do things like shoot 20 frames a second or 30 frames a second, or you can do things like have the autofocus adjust 120 times per second. That's not what the M camera has ever been about. This is a very different camera for a completely different type of photographer. And so it's a really difficult camera, I think, to come up with updates for because it's got such that legacy to it. But what Leica has done with the M11 is, well, several things. So we have enough modernization to where it brings it in line with their other cameras, like the SL2, the SL2S, the Q2. This sits really nicely in that lineup without sacrificing any of the purest rangefinder aesthetic that you have with this camera. M shooters, myself included, we shoot M cameras because we like that rangefinder experience, and they've left all of that intact. But most importantly, image quality is the key upgrade when you're talking about the M10 versus the M11. 14-bit color alone is amazing, and you do see a big difference in the files that come off of an M10 camera versus the M11, and also the ability to be able to resolve at 60 megapixels. And this is very important, and I think Leica have been moving in this direction for a while now. When you look at lenses that they put out lately, like the 50mm aposummicron or even the 35mm aposummicron, these are lenses that, first of all, they're this big, but they have an incredibly high resolution that comes off of these. And so I'm sure that the engineers that work at Leica want to see these higher megapixel sensors to be able to take advantage of the detail that these lenses will give you. But what I think is really cool is they've managed to cross this bridge, which I didn't think could be done. When you go with higher megapixel sensors, it's really difficult to deal with sensitivity, dynamic range when you get into higher ISO settings, and they've actually made it happen. In fact, I found that with this camera, I get really good results with the full 60 megapixels, even in really low light. But if you need to push the camera even harder, you can always lower the resolution and it gets even better. So Leica have given us something that is a very unique system. It's also the only rangefinder still being made. So of course, if you're a rangefinder photographer, this is the only game in town, but they've also given us features that make this extraordinarily unique. There's nothing else on the market that's like this right now. And just for grins, the monochrome version, when we had the M10R and then we had the monochrome version of that sensor, that is still one of my favorite cameras ever made in this entire lineup. The M11, I think, challenges that, but if you want the monochrome experience, I've got a video for you. You should go watch it because I break down the M10 monochrome as well as the Q2 monochrome. Leave a comment below if you have any questions. I'll see you guys in the next video. Until then, later.